two things gather to this man. There are two punishment. No, there are two disturbances that take place with this man. The pain is so intense that Imam says, this is the statement of the first Imam Ali says it. فَغَيْرُ مَوْسُوفٍ مَا نَزَلَ بِهِمْ. Don't even endeavor and embark on trying to understand and describe what the pain is. غَيْرُ مَوْسُوفٍ. It cannot be described. But at that time, two things take place with this individual who's dying. And this is what Imam says. اجتمعت عليه. Two things gather together. One, sakratul maut, the agony of pain, the agony of death, the pain of death. And the second, hasratul faut. Hasrat means remorse. Faut means losing. The remorse of losing something. Not only he is now being subjected to the physical pain, there is also the spiritual pain that now he's leaving the world. And this is what Imam says, the pain is now compounded. The pain is doubled. Not only there is a physical pain, but there is also the spiritual pain. The physical pain because the body, the soul is so attracted to this body, it does not want, this does not want to leave. It's like that last night we mentioned, a satin, a silk cloth on the grass pulls up easily. You place it amongst the thorns, the thorn gets embedded. The likes of this world. Remember those six things the Quran says? حُبِّ زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ. The wives and the children and the money and the property and the wealth and the jewelry. All of these cling to the souls. They don't allow the soul to move. And so now the Malakul Maut has to pull it. Throw out your soul. It needs to go. غَيْرُ مَوْسُوفٍ, the Imam says. And from here begins that segment which is called barzakh. After death, up to the time of death, it's all hadir, everything you see. And Quran says in Surah Baqarah, when you say alif lam mim dhalikal kitab la rayba fi hudan lil muttaqin, that this book has been a guidance for the muttaqin. And then in trying to embark on describing who the muttaqin are, several characteristics are mentioned. The first of them is alladhina yu'minuna bil ghaib, those who believe in the ghaib. Seeing, everybody believes. You don't see God, you believe, that is iman. Seeing, everybody believes. You don't see Jannah, you believe, that is iman. Seeing, everybody believes. You don't see what is happening over there and you believe, that is iman. And that is what Ali says, right? That even if the curtains of the skies were to move aside and I would see the spiritual world that exists with the malaika, with the angels, with the absolute program that takes place in the heavens, my iman is of such a level it will not increase. And this is what is intended, right? But we cannot reach that stage. But now when ghaib comes, when ghaib person becomes now entering into the world of akhirah, into barzakh, now things begin to be seen. Now ghaib becomes hadir. Something that was not to be seen is becoming seen. And the riwayat says the first thing Malakul Maut does is points to the, alaykum salam, points to that individual's tongue. And Imam says he loses the faculty of speech. Because ghaib needs to remain ghaib. It cannot open out. Only in some cases to identify, to tell the people, listen, what my prophets have been telling you, what my imams have been telling you, has credibility, has truth. And hence you find those instances taking place. Those individuals coming from Bani Israel, looking at the grave splitting. These things don't happen on a day-to-day basis. These things happen on a very rare occasion. Because God at times wants to show, move the curtains aside and show to the people, look, these are the realities that exist. But it's not on a daily basis that these things happen. These things need to remain ghaib. And the first thing that Malakul Maut does is points to the person, loses the faculty of speech. Now he witnesses the entire scenario. You heard last night, the Malakul Maut with his entire coterie, with whatever and the paraphernalia that he comes with. Now he watches, he cannot speak. He's seeing the people cry, he wants to tell them, help me out, but he cannot tell them. Because now he's entered into the incident, into the phase, into the realm, which is referred to as barzakh. And this is what it is said. This man, when he sees Malakul Maut and he says, I want to go back, he says, no, you can't go back. The moment you see Malakul Maut, you've crossed into the other world. The moment you've crossed into the other world, behind you there is a barrier. وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ, Quran says, and from behind them there is a barrier. وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ, Up to when is that barrier going to be there? إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ, till the time the person is going to be resurrected. So now there is only that forward movement. Remember we mentioned last night, it's all a forward movement. From the womb into the dunya, from the dunya into the barzakh, from the barzakh into the akhirah. It's a one-way journey. Now this is what we need to understand over here. That having embarked on it, and this is where the real discussion of this ashra begins. That when man enters into barzakh, barzakh it's an Arabic term. It's the term is barrier. Another word is sadd. The sadd, you know, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا وَهُمْ لَا. You heard about it. Barrier. It's a barrier. It does not allow a person to go back. And this barrier starts, and this region starts from the time a person visualizes Malakul Maut. Once he sees Malakul Maut, he's into barzakh. Once he's into the barzakh, now he will see unseen things. Now he cannot communicate with the people. And it is at this point of time that we need to understand that over there in barzakh, it is an entirely different world. It is an absolute similar world as we are in, but in a more expansive nature. Remember we mentioned the relationship of the first sky to the second sky and the second sky to the third sky. And we mentioned how from the womb into the world when the child comes, how he sees an expansive world. And from the world, from the world when he goes into barzakh, he will see an even more expansive world. And from barzakh into qiyamah, an even more expansive world. Now suddenly he's going into a world, he's seeing things absolutely different. And that is why it said, the first night when a person goes into barzakh is the first night of qabr. Ihdharu, beware of that first night of qabr. And hence all the responsibilities, majority of the responsibilities comes in that first night of qabr. Do this, do this, do this, do this. Recommendations specifically for the first night of qabr. Why? Because that is the time now. He's coming first time into a new location, into a new locality, into a new surrounding, into a new environment, into new happenings, into new entities. Never seen angels before. Never seen angels of azab before. All now coming before him, shadid. But having come into this action, into this, we need to understand that there is a certain relationship between that world and this world. And there are a few misconceptions that we need to take it across. These things we keep hearing about ghouls and ghosts and bhoot and all those things. We need to realize those are things that we don't attest to. And we need to understand there is a reason for that. And the reason for that is, look, we don't have several worlds. We've got the world of the womb, we've got the world of the dunya, and then we've got the world of the akhirah. That akhirah is divided into two phase stages. One before resurrection, one after resurrection. As soon as a person sees Malakul Maut, his akhirah has begun. His akhirah having begun, now it's divided into two phases. The barzakh, from the time he dies till the day he's asked to stand up. And from the day he's asked to stand up, forever and ever, hum fiha khalidun. Ayatul Kursi says what? Ulaika ashabun nar hum fiha khalidun, forever and ever. Now in this state, all these are under absolute control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all these worlds have their limitations and have their own rules. So the rule of the womb, in the womb of the mother, it has its own rules. You cannot reach out, you cannot touch, you cannot kiss your child. There are certain limitations. Once they come over here in this world, there are limitations. You cannot come out whenever you want to come. You cannot die whenever you want to die. Even when somebody commits suicide, he doesn't die according to his own will. We don't believe in that God who does not dictate everything. We don't believe in a God who does not have authority over everything. He's got authority over life. He's got authority over death. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةِ. He has created life, he has created death. If you and me have the authority to take our life, that means that God, in terms of this action of mine, is impotent. I am doing it out of my own will. Death is by means of God. Life is by means of God. I come into this world when I want to come. No, I come into this world when God wants me to come. Do I go out of this world when I want to go? No, I don't go out of this world when I want to go. I go out of this world when that Almighty Lord wants us to go. Then what about suicide? Suicide is exactly the classification of how a person identifies the death that he wants. When you say a person commits suicide, when a person is murdered, when bombs are dropped, when individuals are killed, a plane is crashed, whatever happens, at one time those individuals die. Let it not be a misconception that it was brought about by this terrorist. It was brought about by this. He committed a suicide bombing, so he killed himself. His death was ordained at that time. He would have died anyway at that time. You know that incident about Ali, na? When he wants to go into the mosque to pray, he takes his horse. As he's going into the mosque to pray, he's looking around, who can take care of his horse. He sees a man. He says, "Can you take care of my horse?" He says, "Yes." So he gives the horse to him. He goes into the mosque to pray. Understand, everything lies in the hands of God. We don't believe in a God who's impotent. We don't believe in a God who does not have complete authority. He is one, this is the Islamic belief, complete and absolute authority over the entire world of existence. Fa'alul lima yurid, he does what he wants. Ali goes into the mosque, says, "Takes care of my horse." He says, "Yes." He goes into the mosque. Ali prays, comes back, sees the horse is there, but the saddle was not there. Saddle was of a good quality, very expensive one. So the companions say, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, this person has stolen your saddle. He says, "Doesn't matter." Ali knows what is happening. He says, "Let's go to the bazaar. I'll purchase another one." He goes to the bazaar. His companions are around with him. Suddenly they look at the shop. They say, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, this is your saddle." He looks at him and he sees in one of the shop the same saddle that he had upon his horses lying over there. So he goes to the shopkeeper. Shopkeeper sees him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, what is it? He's saying, "The saddle." He's saying, yes, the saddle somebody has just given to me. Somebody sold it to me. He sold it to me dirt cheap, so I bought it. He said, "How much did you sell it to him for? How much did he sell it to you for?" So I got it dirt cheap. I want to sell it for 100 dirhams, but I got it for 3 dirhams. That man stole Ali's saddle, went there and sold it for 3 dirhams. When the shopkeeper tells Ali, I purchased this from 3 dirhams. Ali turns to his ashab and says, "You know what? I was going to give him 3 dirhams as a bakshish for having taken care of my saddle. In his destiny, it was only 3 dirhams. But in your hands is whether you earn it the halal way or the haram way. He was going to get 3 dirhams, not more. I was going to give him 3 dirhams for taking care of my saddle. But he did not want to earn it the halal way. He took it, he sold it, he robbed it, and he sold it. He earned the same 3 dirhams, the haram money." You don't go beyond that boundary. Similarly, when it comes to death, that person who blows his chest up, who blows the female partner who's in the room next to him, that death was ordained at that time. Had it not been for his individual actions, he would have met death somehow or the other, because it was ordained. We don't believe in God in which we dictate things to him. We believe in a God who dictates things to us. And so when we enter into this world, we don't have these concepts of ghosts. There is no such thing as ghosts. We see, you know, we have these traditional people who tend to believe that, and this is even in our families, that if you die a bad death, if you die out of trouble, if you die out of misery, if somebody is murdered, if somebody is killed, if somebody commits suicide, his soul moves around hanging in tree. There's no tree business over here. It's either dunya or barzakh. Each of them have their own rulings. You cannot come out of barzakh once you're inside. Once the soul leaves the body, it's all controlled, ruled by God. There is no way individuals can come out. This concept that you keep hearing, every Shab-e-Jumah, our relatives come outside in our houses. It's not a correct concept. This you've been hearing, and I'm going to tell you from here. It is not a correct concept. Not that it is not a completely wrong concept. It is correct to a certain extent. Bear with me for some time. I'm not saying they don't come. But I want to prove to you everything works with mechanisms, with laws, with rules, with authority, with God has set up. They come, riwayat say, Sadiqain has said, the Prophet has said, our relatives come, not every Shab-e-Jumah. Not that not every Shab-e-Jumah, wait for a few days. Before we end, we will clarify this. They come. But this concept that every relative comes every Shab-e-Jumah is not correct. Don't get me wrong, don't start your WhatsApp messages. Don't start your WhatsApp messages. Get me right. I'm saying every relative, every Shab-e-Jumah, no. Some relatives, Shab-e-Jumah, yes. Some relatives, some Shab-e-Jumah, yes. What I'm saying is every relative, every person who has died comes every Thursday, no. Says who? The riwayat, not now, when we talk later. But when this comes, we have to understand everything is bound. And there is a communication between that world and this world. After the Battle of Badr, When the Mushrikeen killed, you know, Battle of Badr, right? 17th of the month of Ramadan, the first battle, the first decisive battle. Had Islam perished, lost, Islam would have been struck off the face of the earth. 313 from Islam, 1,000 from the Kufar, where whatever happens. Badr won. Now the body is lying over there. What do we do of the Mushrikeen? Prophet says, dig a big grave. Put everybody inside. So the whole grave was dug up. Just put it inside. It was put inside. As they were putting inside, as they were covering it up, the Prophet stands at the edge of the pit and says, Ya Ahl al-Qalib, Hal wajadtum ma wa'adakum Rabbukum haqqa fa'inni wajadtu ma wa'adani Rabbi haqqa. He turns to those people who are dead and says, now the Muslimin are watching, huh? The battle is just finished. He's saying, O people of Badr, did you find what God, your Lord, has promised you to be truth? Because I have found what my God has promised me to be the truth. Now he's talking to them. One of the companions comes and says, Ya Rasulullah, hal yasma'un? Are they listening? So the Prophet turns to him and says, my friend, they are listening more than what you listen to me. The only difference is, walakin la yujibun. They do not have the authority to reply. Everything is working with certain rules and regulations. In that stage, they hear, you cannot, they cannot talk to you. Certain cases, it changes. Bishartiha wa shurutiha, but those shirk will come. So there is a proof. There are ways when communication takes place. And there are ways, and there have been, this is just an introduction, right? Just as we started with the introduction of death, a little introduction before we go into the intricacies, because we still need to go further, a long way. When, all of you have heard about Allama Tabatabai, the Sahib Tafsir al-Mizan. Ajab, ihsan he's done upon the Shiites in terms of tafsir. And I keep telling this, whenever first time I speak to a Jamaat about Allama Tabatabai, This man, what he has done for Islam in terms of Quran. Up to Tafsir al-Mizan was released, our heads were always low when it came to the Sunni scholars in terms of Quran and Tafsir. Because Tafsir, kama on chinan ke bayat bashad, the way it ought to have been dealt with was never dealt with upon in the Shiite world till Tafsir al-Mizan comes. Tafsir al-Mizan came and then the Shiites lifted their heads up. Ajab, ihsan he's done in terms of tafsir to the Ahlul Tashayyu. But this man, he had a brother. Allama Tabatabai had a brother. This family is a family of religious scholars. All of them, not just scholars. Ajab scholars these are. He's got a brother, and he had a brother in Tabriz. They were in Tabriz, then from there they moved to Qum, then Najaf, then Qum again. There he started his Dars of Tafsir and Falsafa before he eventually passes away. He had a brother in Tabriz. I told you, the family of scholars. His brother had a speciality in something which is called Ihdarul Arwah. There are certain amal that can be done. See, Islam gives a lot of amal for certain things that are non-ordinary. They're out of the ordinary. He had an amal that could be done by means of which he would request, by means of du'as and ziyarat, for certain ruh of individuals who had passed away from Barzakh to come before him. But this doesn't come all of a sudden. This, you require spiritual refinement, spiritual purification. Just as you have, for example, du'as, that if you recite, you can see your dead who have passed away. We will discuss that later. Or certain du'as, certain amal that can... Now this is sensitive. Don't come back to me, because this is something that is... The riwayat say there are certain amal by means of which you can actually watch. Ulama have done it. You can watch what has happened in Karbala. But only up to a certain time. Riwayat say up to a certain time you can see it. After that nobody can see. And it's only Imam Zamana who can see the actual maqtal of Hussain. But that's a different issue. Over here, now, Allama Tabatabai, his brother Tabri in Tabriz, he has this ability to do the ihdar. So he would request, he would do the ihdar, he would call and summon the rules of Mujtahideen, Sheikh Murtada Ansari, Allama Tabatabai, Sheikh Kulaini, fulan. So somebody goes to him and says, you've done the ihdar of majority of these big scholars, And he would call them, masala, something would come up, puchna hai, kuch daryaf karna hai. He would call them, he would talk to them, they would tell them what is happening. So somebody comes and tells him that you've been doing the ihdar, the summoning of the arwah of all these major mujtahideen and scholars. Is there anyone that you find difficult to call? So look, it's been years I've been doing it. There have been individuals from the general public, I call them based on the maslahat. There have been scholars that I call them. Whenever I call, they would come. Ayatollah Araki, Fulan, they would come, they would talk to me. I would ask them, not for the fun of it, not just for the heck of it, for some shar'i mas'ala, shar'i reason, they want to know. I said, except for two individuals. Two individuals, for however long I have tried, I've never been able to get them to come. However effort, I have gone and asked for the most biggest of scholars that I think could come. And all of them came except two individuals. Two individuals, however much I try to call their souls, they don't come. One is Sayyid ibn Taus. He will talk about this man, Sayyid ibn Taus. Ajab personalities we've got, huh? One is Sayyid ibn Taus, one is Sayyid Mahdi Baharul Ulum. So these two individuals, whenever I tried to call them, they would never answer me. And I would keep wondering, ulama of the absolute highest stature, they would come, they would talk to me. These two individuals don't come. Till one day I called one of the scholars and I asked them, when I'm trying to get these two individuals, Sayyid ibn Taus, Radiuddin ibn Taus, this Ibn Taus family, Ajib family, this whole lineage, there are certain things, Shajarai Tayyiba, Quran says, these are those Shajarai Tayyiba, those lineage, Ibn Taus family. So Sayyid Ibn Taus doesn't come. Sayyid Mahdi Baharul Ulum doesn't come. So the scholar who had come said, they will never come. So why will they not come? Every time I call others, everybody would come. He said, no, in Barzakh, there are certain rules and regulations. There are certain nizam that works over there. And in the nizam of Barzakh, these two individuals are the special khadameen of Amirul Mu'mineen. Till Ali does not give them the permission, they will not come. See, things work. It's not ad hoc. We don't have souls hanging up to the branches of trees just because they've committed suicide or just because they've been murdered. We don't have these concepts. Our concept is an all-powerful God, that when he wants to assert himself, he asserts himself Al-Qahhar Al-Jabbar. But then when he wants to be Rahman, then he can be Rahman and Rahim. So in this barzakh, you find that such instances do take place. But what happens when the soul comes out and the barzakh begins? Rawat say, when the soul comes out of a human body, see, the soul is the essence of man. It needs a vehicle to move around with. In this world, the body is the vehicle of the soul. The essence is the soul. The body once created can get disintegrated. The soul once created cannot be disintegrated. It becomes immortal. And this is what the Quran says. Remember, when you're talking about the evil people, hum fiha khalidun. When you're talking about the good people, what it is said? When they enter paradise, it is said, Udkhuluha bisalamin, dhalika yawmul khuld. Enter into this paradise, because now, from here, now that you enter, there is no death. It's immortality. Soul is immortal. Soul can never die. Soul can never disintegrate, will never perish. The body, yes. But the soul, when it wants to move, it needs a vehicle. Unless it is in the spiritual world. In the material world, it needs a body. So this is the body it requires. It is by means of this body, the soul does everything. That means now when you want to watch, when the soul wants to see, it uses the fat of the eye. You heard now what Imam says when he's trying to highlight the pasti of man and the greatness of Lord. He's saying, ajab Lord this is that we've got. An ajab man this Lord has made. See, do you realize your creation? You are a creation that watches by means of fat and talks by means of a flesh, a piece of flesh, and hears by means of bones. This is what you are. It is true. You hear, you see by your fat. Eye lump is what? Eyeballs. It's a piece of fat. You talk by what? By means of the tongue, which is a piece of flesh. You hear by what? Those three little bones in the ear, in the canal, that reverberates and brings about the concept of thinking. But the point that we need to understand is that it's the soul that actually listens and hears and sees. But it uses these concepts, these physical things to actually see. So when the soul wants to see, because it is in the material world, it needs the help of the material eyes. Because it is in the material ear world, because it wants to hear, it will use the material ears. Because it wants to talk, it will use the material tongue to talk. It uses this. It's not the eyes that see, it's the soul that sees. It's not the tongue that talks, it's the soul that talks. It's not the ears that hear, it's the soul that hears. And that is why when a person dies and the body is there and now there is no soul, the eyes is there but the body doesn't see. When the tongue is there but the tongue doesn't speak. The ears are there but the ears don't speak. What is it difference between 2 minutes prior and 2 minutes now? The essence is missing. The ears are there but they don't see because the soul is not there. The tongue is there but it doesn't speak because why? The soul is not there. The soul sees, the soul talks. So while in this world the soul requires a body, when it goes and it's taken out from this body, the vehicle for this is left off. It's so easy nowadays to understand this, huh? You know these rockets that are launched, the satellites that take place? You have these stations, space stations or space centers that launch these rockets. Have you ever observed how it takes place? You have the actual rocket, if you say Space Shuttle Columbia, you have the actual shuttle on a different level. First you need boosters to push it into space. So you have these boosters that go up to a certain level, they will push that rocket or that satellite, then the boosters fall off. The second generation of boosters take over and then they take it up in space and then they fall off. And the third set of boosters take place till they take it outside the force of gravity. Once outside the force of gravity, the satellite is left. Now the satellite works by solar energy that it captures during the day. What do those boosters do? The boosters serve as vehicles for the actual essential fact, essential issue, essential thing, which is the satellite. This body is exactly the same. The essence is the soul. In this world, it requires the body. When the time is up for the soul to go into the next world, this booster is discarded, finished. It drops down into the sea. For us, it drops down into the earth, eaten away by insects. Not required, useless, khalas, finished. But when this body goes into the second world, then the situation starts. Because then that is the start of barzakh. And the start of barzakh is characterized by innumerable ahadith by the imams and the prophets that beware of this now. And not just the imams and the prophets and the holy prophet. We're talking about riwayat from the time of Isa alayhi salam. Maryam passes away, Bibi Maryam salamullahi alayha passes away. Isa sees her in his dreams. He's saying, "Ya Umma, O mother, it's been such a long time, I've been missing you. You were very close." That's why when the relationship has been mentioned, initially when Isa comes and talks, that's what he says. He says, "I've been asked to be good to my mother." They have a very close relationship. Probably because there was no father. Probably because of the scandals that were hurled against Maryam. Isa was very close to Maryam. He sees her in the dream, "Mother, how are you? How are things?" She says, "I'm fine." So he asks her a question. He says, "Ma, do you want to come back into this world?" She says, "Yes, I want to come back into the world." He says, "For what?" And she says, "Isa, this journey is very difficult. This journey of the Akhirat is very difficult." So then Isa asks her, "But then why do you want to come back?" He says, "You know why I want to come back? This journey is so difficult. I want to come back for two things. I want to come back for two things. I want to come back so that in the cold nights I stand up for the salat of Allah, and in the summer months I wake awake in the day and fast for Allah. I want to come back for these two things because I've observed that in that long journey of the Akhirah, these two things help out the most, the salat and saum." I got this. Even on those times, Maryam, she's a masuma, right? She's a masuma. We say 14 masoom with respect to this. In the lady, she's a masooma. She's saying the journey is difficult. And you heard last time what we say. Zainul Abidin sitting and crying. Rabi comes and says, "Yabna Rasulullah, lima tabki? Why are you crying? Why are you weeping?" He says, Lima la abki. He answers, answering by a question. The Rabbi says, why are you crying? The Imam says, why should I not cry? And then he starts off. I mentioned a little bit explanation. He says, abki li khuruj nafsi. Wa abki li wahshat qabri. Wa abki li dhiq lahdi. Wa abki li su'al munkar wa nakir iyaya fi qabri. Wa abki li khuruji min qabri. ذليلا حاملا ثقلي على ظهري. He says, why should I not cry? I am crying thinking of the time when Malakul Maut will come and take the soul from within me. You heard what Ibrahim had to face to when Malakul Maut had to come. Not that we have any semblance of a doubt that Ibrahim was inferior to Sajjad. We have no semblance of a doubt that Malakul Maut is one of the most base servants of Sajjad. But look at the concept of Sajjad. He says, abki li khuruj nafsi. I think of the time when Malakul Maut will come and take out my soul. I weep for that time. I weep when I think that I will be going into my grave. Wahshat qabri, the fear of the grave, the confinedness of the grave, the darkness of the grave. I think about these things and I cry. Sajjad can cry. It doesn't affect us. Sajjad is absolutely masoon. He is protected from all of this. Yet he cries, you and me not protected. I just don't want to worry about it. We will see when that happens. So I will see when that happens. And this is what Ali wrote to Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr was one of his governors. He says, Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, in your dealing with the people, remember, innama ba'ad al maut. He says, whatever is going to take place after death, understand Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, it's going to be more shadeed than what is there at the time of death. Time of death, you just heard what Ali said. You heard the description that took place. You heard those individuals from Bani Israel. 99 years, that old man says, I still feel the pain of death. Ali says, my friend, what is after death is more shadeed than what is at the time of death. You cannot describe. Just understand when I tell you, it's going to be more shadeed. And so when you come into this, you realize it. That as the soul is taken out from the body of man, this vehicle, this booster is left out. But the soul needs another booster because now it's going into the world of Barzakh. Barzakh is not a spiritual world. So it needs another place for it to be moving in. And there, the reward say, you will be given, I will be given, all of us will be given a body similar to this body. But there is a difference in this body and there's a difference in that body. The body would be the same, means the characteristics would be the same. The features would be the same. The color would be the same. Somebody from Africa will not appear like somebody from Norway. The features would remain the same. The body would remain the same, but the characteristic would change. The soul now goes into that body which is referred to as a duplicate body, which in Arabic is referred to as badane mithali. It is referred to as a replicative body that resembles exactly this. And the riwayat, then the Rabi asks the Imam, but if it's another body, if it is not this body that we are used to, then how will people recognize? He says, people will be recognized. He says, when people go into Barzakh, when the souls go over there, they are put into a body that is a mithali body, that is appropriate with that realm. This body, flesh and blood, is appropriate with the material world. That body is associated with that world. Let me explain. In the entire world of existence and creation of God, God has created numerous entities, the malaika, the hajar, the shajar, the insan, the haywan, the charindagan, the parindagan, the malaika, the jinn. All of these can be classified into three categories. Into two categories. Let me just break it up. One is a category which is a non-corporeal body entity. That means they are not physical entities. They have nothing that is called matter. Entities without matter. Entities without physical structure. Entities that are not corporeal, non-corporeal entities. That means they've got nothing called matter. So example of soul, ruh. Ruh is not matter. Ruh doesn't have any physical structure. Ruh is spiritual. It is not corporeal. Ruh is not spiritual. It's spiritual, is not corporeal. The second category consists of those that are physical in nature. that is that are made up of matter. So people like you and me, animals made up of matter, plants made up of matter, wood made up of matter, metal made up of matter. These are all material things. Light is matter, photon is matter. It may be very minute, but it is matter. This cannot be compared to a soul. Light, when you put across an opaque object, does not go through, because matter hits matter, cannot go through. Soul doesn't need that. Soul goes straight through it. You put a person into a room, lock all the windows, lock all the doors, the soul will still move out of the body. It does not need, because it is not made up of matter. Amongst those that are made up of matter, the physical structure, there are two categories. One is hard matter, like us, like the photons. These lice, photons, these are matter, hard matter. One matter is subtle matter, which is called Jism Latif, very subtle. From Jism Latif has been made the jinn. The jinn that have been created are from matter, but they are of a subtle matter. Light, you may think it is a very subtle light, but it is not. It is made up of hard photons. The only thing is the photons are very, very minuscule, but they are still hard matter. Jinn are made of matter, but very subtle. And hence, when they want to move, they don't require any matter to protect them or inhibit them. They want to move through walls, they will just go through walls. But they are still matter. They're not non-matter. They're not spiritual entities. So you have man, hard matter. You have angels, absolutely spiritual, no matter. And then you've got jinn, which is referred to as semi-spiritual or Jism Latif. And hence you would find that because they're not confined by matter, they can take the forms, whatever they want. Riwayat say they can take any forms. Riwayat say between angels exactly the same, that are those that are spiritual in nature are not bound by any material confines. So you find angels are not bound by the limitations of matter, because they're not matter, they are spiritual entities. So somebody asks, Ya Rasulullah, how many angels has God created and how do they occupy spaces? Now, in order for him to explain that, look, these are not material things, they don't take up space. So he says, you know, if you take a needle, the needle tip, 100,000 angels can be standing on the tip of a needle, because it does not require matter. They're spiritual entities. But jinn, they're subtle entities. They are semi-spiritual, so they will go through walls. When they want to move, you know that incident about Bilqis and the throne of Bilqis, and Suleiman says, who will bring the throne of Bilqis? Kala afritu min al-jinn, I will bring it to you before you stand up. Then somebody comes and says, ana atika, I will bring it to you, qabla an tartadda ilayka aynak tarafuk, before you blink. And he goes and brings it. That was exactly what the jinn goes, he brings it, he says, I'll go and bring it before. This was somebody else, somebody from people of knowledge. But that is what the jinns can do. They can travel long distances, far off places, in the blinking of an eye, because they're not bound by time, they're not bound by matter. This soul, when it goes into barzakh, goes into that mithal. And that is what that life is about. That is what that entire world is over there. That is a world that is very similar to ours, but not exactly like ours. Means what? The closest comparison that the ulama give about that world in barzakh, about that life in barzakh, is something that is the state of dreams. See, when you're in the dreams, you see your friends, you see your relatives, you go out with friends, you feel the pain, you feel anguish, you feel stressed, you feel ecstatic, you feel joyous, you feel bliss, you feel happy, you hurt yourself, you feel the pain. But there is no matter. It's a light world. It's a very subtle world. So everything that you do in this world is there. So somebody is so fond of football and he wants to see Barcelona versus Manchester United, and he loses, he sees his favorite team is lost. He goes into the dream, he will replay the same match, but now he will make sure that his favorite team wins. And he will shout, and he will enjoy, and he will see the goals being scored, and he will hear the sounds of people shouting, and he will see the Mexican wave, and he will see everything except that it is a very light world. He experiences the same thing as we experience over here. But in this world, you have weight. You are confined. In that world, you are not confined. It is a semi-spiritual world. And this is what is referred to as Jism Mithali and the Barzakh that takes place. But from here then begins the story that makes things very difficult to understand. Because now this is what the Riwayat keeps saying. That's now when this man goes, he begins to see things that he's never seen before. ये ऐसी ऐसी चीजों को देखता है कि जो इंसान कभी देखा ही नहीं है. क्योंकि एक मर्तबा जब मलकुल मौत को देखा, वो जो पूरा अंदाजा जो हो रहा है, वो पूरी चीजें जो होती हैं. और बार बार इमाम कहते हैं कि ये जो चीज है इससे बहुत डरो. मौलाए मुत्तकियान का जो है फरमान है कि देखो जब मरने के बाद तुम ऐसी ऐसी चीजों को देखोगे तो जो है बहुत खतरनाक चीजें हैं. और याद रखो ये जो खबर जो जहां तुम जाने वाले हो ना, इसको तुम जो है ऐसी चीज ना समझना कि जो समझ जिसमें समझ नहीं, जिसमें शऊर नहीं. हर वो चीज जिसने खुदा जिसको खुदा ने खल्क किया है उसमें शऊर है, उसमें एक समझ है. इसीलिए रिवायत है इमाम की कि अपने लोगों से बता रहे अपने आमाल को सुधारो, अपने रवैये को सुधारो. वरना ये जो जगह तुम जाने वाले हो जिसको कब्र कहा जाता है, वो बार बार दिन में जो है तीन मर्तबा पुकारती है, अना बैतुल वहशा, वो अना बैतुल गुरबा, वो अना बैतुल दूद वल हवाम. मैं जो हूं ये वहशत का घर हूं, मैं जो हूं गुरबत का घर हूं, मैं जो हूं एक ठिकाना हूं जहां कीड़े मकोड़े आने वाले हैं. तो इसी कीड़े मकोड़े में तुम्हें आना है. रिवायत में मिलता है कि जब एक मोमिन इंसान जमीन पर से गुजरता है, अर्श पर से गुजरता है, तो जहां कब्र जमीन जो है वो कहती है कि तू जो है खुदा का नाफरमा बरदार बंदा है, मुतवज्जे रहना कि तुझे मेरे अंदर आना है. और जब तू मेरे अंदर आएगा तो फिर मैं तुझसे जो सुलूक करूंगी वो तू जानेगा और खुदा जानेगा. बाज रिवायत में है कि जो है एक जमीन जिस पर जो है गुनहगार इंसान चलता है, वो खुदा से पनाह मांगती है कि खुदा इसको मेरे अंदर ना भेजना, क्योंकि मुझे पता है कि इसके साथ क्या हशर होने वाला है. ये बर्दाश्त कर सके कि ना कर सके मैं नहीं जानती, मगर मैं तेरे अजाब को बर्दाश्त ना कर सकूंगी. इसी वजह से ऑन द फ्लिप साइड जो नेक मोमिन जमीन पर चलता हुआ नजर आता है, ये जो है कब्र पुकारती है, मैं मुश्ताक हूं, आ जा मेरे पास, जल्द आ, मैं तेरा इंतजार करूंगी, क्योंकि मैं जानती हूं कि जब तू आएगा तो जो है साथ में अल्लाह की रहमत लेकर आएगा. फिर दुआ करती है खुदा के साथ, खुदा के पास, ए परवरदिगारा इसे जल्दी मुझ में नाजिल कर, इसको जल्दी जो है मेरे पास भेज, मैं चाहती हूं कि मैं खुद जो है इसके साथ साथ तेरी नेमतों से बरखुरदार हो जाऊं. मगर ये चीज हम समझ नहीं सकते, ये चीज हम सुन नहीं सकते, क्योंकि हमारे कानों पे, हमारे आंखों पे जो पर्दा पड़ चुका है दुनियावी मादियात का, वो छह चीजों का जो कुरान बयान फरमाता है कि इंसान इन चीजों में इतना जकड़ गया है कि उसकी जो है आंख, उसके कान इस तरह जकड़ गए हैं दुनिया के लहव लाभ में कि फिर मावरा दुनिया उसको कुछ समझ में नहीं आता. यही अल्लामा तबा